Welcome to the 2015 Bowerman Awards. I'm your host for the red carpet tonight, Ryan Fenton, alongside my beautiful co-host, Queen Harrison. Queen, how you doing out there?
I'm great. I'm excited to be out here. I love that I was a winner in the past, and now I'm able to be a part of the show in a different capacity.
So we're in our seventh year of the Bowerman Awards, and this thing has just taken off over the years. You were the second winner on the women's side. What's it been like being a part of this over the years?
Goodness, it's amazing to see how it grows every single year. I mean, it's telling my age a little bit that I was the second winner, but either way, I love that I'm a part of it every year, and I'm going to continue to be a part of it because it's really important to our sport.
You were young when you won, though, right?
Yeah, and yeah. I'm still young now, so that's nothing.
So, six more finalists this year, three on the women's side, three on the men. What has impressed you about the athletes you've seen over the past year?
Oh, goodness, all of them. I mean, it's going to be a really tough race. All of the finalists are amazing athletes and amazing people. I got to sit down and talk to a couple of them while we've been here, so it's going to be amazing to see, hear from them when they're interviewed with John and just award one of them. They all deserve it, so I'm excited to see who will win.
When you were here and you were sitting against those three finalists, did you know you were going to win? Was it up in the air? What do you remember thinking before they announced you as a winner?
That's the thing. Every year they bring the best of the best. So as much as you may be confident and think that you had great performances that year, it could be anyone. So I was just as nervous as here as I am on the line for a track meet, because on any given day, it could be anybody, and the same thing for the Bowerman.
Well, we're going to find out what happens tonight, and we are going to start calling up some guests on this red carpet. All the athletes will be filtering through, some big names that will be part of the show, and our first guest tonight here at the JW Marriott is Mr. Sam Seams.
Sam,
step right in the middle here. Let's get you front and center.
How are you all?
We are great. How are you doing tonight?
I'm good and terrific. Getting ready to do better.
This award was kind of your brainchild in the association. You guys thought about this over 7 years ago, and now in its seventh year, how do you feel when you step into this thing and see the athletes that have come through?
Oh, I feel absolutely great. It's amazing the athletes, the high level performance that they've achieved during their collegiate career, and we've seen now that we've had seven past winners, really 14 men and women, where they've gone on and achieved great world fame as well. But one thing that I've really enjoyed is getting to know the student athletes who have come through and found out what great just human beings that they are. Really, really, really great people.
I think they're the same excited to meet you because, once again, like we said, you are the one who came up with this idea. Any new things that you want to see in the future as this continues to grow?
Well, this year we're going to have a delayed broadcast of this after the first of the year on ESPNU, which will be our first time. And being someone that's kind of optimistic, we think this is a first step that next year or the following year, this whole event will be live on TV.
Yes, I think we're definitely going in that direction.
Great.
Well, Sam, we know you got to get in there and get ready for this thing. And you mentioned ESPN, so we actually have someone that might know a little bit thing about ESPN coming up here.
I hear he stops by there every now and then. John Anderson has been a godsend for us. He brings the personality. He's the signature of the event. We're great to have him back.
Awesome. Thanks so much,
Thanks
Sam.
Thanks for joining us.
Thank you.
So, Queen, ESPN, John Anderson, back again, and here is the man. How's it going, sir?
We can get a couple words from him. How you doing?
Your fourth time.
I know. This is it, and then I'm out of eligibility, and they got to bring somebody else in. I think. I don't know. Maybe I could be like a graduate transfer, whatever they have, one of those. But, I think this is my last one, and then I have to go on and find something else.
So last year was your redshirt year? Is that what you're saying?
I could say that. Last year was, hey, my son has a Christmas concert, and my wife said, you got to go hear Jingle Bells. So off we went.
Ryan decided to take over your position last year, so does that mean you're going to have to upstage him again this year?
No, we're teamwork. We are not about upstaging whatsoever. No. And actually, the beauty of this, really, and you know since you were there, it is really a celebration of these six athletes, or at least that's what I hope it is. I hope I don't get in the way of that. I hope everybody sees these finalists, the three men and the three women, for the great seasons they had, and then one of them recognized beyond that. But really, hopefully, this 90 minutes, 40, 80, whatever it's going to be, is a celebration of those six kids, because they deserve it. They're great.
It doesn't hurt to bring a little extra celebrity into the party every once in a while.
Right, and I don't know if we can get that person here, but we'll do what we can.
Sam just mentioned that this will be on ESPNU in a few weeks, a kind of a new step for this award. What's that like? You're obviously part of that ESPN family and bringing this to that audience.
I keep pushing. The only thing that's going to bother me is it might be confusing because we're into, you know, indoors by then already. But, you know, we're sort of expanding our coverage a lot, whether it's both SEC indoor and outdoor, NCAA's indoor and outdoor. We're going to do a meet in Fayetteville on the indoor season. I think we've about tied up the Drake relay. So we're bringing more and more track and field to ESPN. And then because we have so many networks, it's not just ESPNU or SEC Network. Last year, Nationals, we moved a lot of it from ESPN3 and ESPN2 onto the main channel. And what we found is people watch. They're fans, and they love the sport. So hopefully we'll give them more of that.
Awesome. And that's great to hear. People love this thing. Well, you got a big job ahead. We're going to let you go in there, John. Thanks so much for being here.
I want to talk to Laura anyway. And I think the dress is salmon. She's going pink, but whatever it is, it's lovely.
We're going to find out in a second. Thank you, John.
All right. So next up, we're going to call some of our past winners on the female side. Three lovely ladies coming up and joining us. Laura Raisler,
hello.
Jessica Beard, and Brianna Rollins all up on the stage.
Hello, ladies.
Everyone looking very beautiful tonight. How's everyone feeling?
We're great. Thank you.
Jess, how about you?
I feel good. Just waiting to see who wins.
Now, I remember before the show started tonight, Laura mentioned about the dress, the pink. You were really excited about this thing. How are you feeling in it now?
Way less nervous than last year.
Yeah, once you've gone through it, it's a lot less nerve-wracking. Is there any advice that any of you want to give to the finalists tonight that maybe what you were thinking about or staying cool and calm and collective before they announce those names? Jessica, we'll go with you.
I just want all of them just to remember that no matter who wins, they're all great. And just to even have made it this far from all the collegiate athletes to 10 to now 3. And just to really just enjoy the moment and just be proud of what they've accomplished in their collegiate season and then use that as motivation to move forward in their professional careers.
Speaking of, I mean, we've had world champions that have been Bowerman Awards winners, most notably Brianna Rollins. We like to get a little bit, what about you? Do you have any inspiration or anything to say to the finalists when they come up here?
Well, just come out here and have fun, relax, and just enjoy the moment. Everybody's a winner no matter what. Just being in the top three here is a great accomplishment.
Any predictions?
I don't want to say. I don't. She has to say that.
Someone's biased over here. Well, we have to ask the question. Is this salmon or is this
pink? Teammate Kendra to win, but.
Some have said coral. I say pink.
So the dress is pink. Okay, we've got the answer.
All right, well, we're going to let you ladies go in there and get seated. But thanks so much for being back once again this year. It's an honor to have you guys here.
Thanks for coming, ladies.
All right, you guys can step out this way. All right, so three former winners, four with you up here.
Yeah, we had a full house.
And two hurdlers were just up on the stage, and we're actually going to call another hurdler up here.
I might be a little biased.
Hurdlers
myself.
Just Goodness. Dominating here.
So beautiful. Hi, Kendra. How you doing?
Kendra Harrison from University of Kentucky. Unbelievable year last year. What's it feel like to be here with us?
It feels amazing. You know, I'm just really blessed to be here and just to see what I accomplished. You know, it means a lot, and I'm really proud that my parents are here, and, you know, it's a great moment.
Do you happen, so you do the 100-meter hurdles and the 400-meter hurdles. Do you have a favorite?
No, I do not have a favorite, but, of course, the 100 hurdles is the shorter race, so, of course, that's always a good thing.
It's shorter, but it's not necessarily easier, is it? Because it's pretty competitive in the U.S.
No, of course not. You know, the U.S. has the top 100 hurdlers, so, you know, I think it's just it's great for us.
Yeah, it's great to watch. I mean, seeing you compete, especially at the NCAA championships, it was amazing to watch.
And I know a few other ladies that have done the 100 and 400 double. Anyone that's inspiration for you?
Queen Harrison, of course.
Maybe we're cousins. I'm thinking the Harrison connection. Who knows?
Nice. Well, best of luck out there tonight, and we can't wait to see what happens.
Thank you.
Congratulations.
All right, so our first finalist up there, what did you think?
Finalist.
She looked good? She looked nervous?
She looked good. She looked nervous. But if you're not nervous, then you're not ready for big things.
Well, I think it's time for our next finalist here. Demi Payne.
Hello.
How's it going? Hi. Great to see you.
How you doing? You look gorgeous.
Oh, thank you so much. Gosh, everyone looks so good.
So, big company tonight. I know only the second female pole vaulter up for this award. What's it like to be down here in San Antonio?
Oh, man. I mean, just to be a finalist, I feel like I've won. You know, it's a very big honor, and I think it's a big deal to my school and to my family, and it's amazing. You know, it really is.
Speaking of family, we all heard you have a little one. So do you feel like that's extra motivation as you go in to compete in each of these track meets, knowing that you're a mother in addition to a student athlete?
Oh, my gosh, yeah. I feel like I have an unfair advantage because I have a child. And, I mean, I swear I can be on the runway and take one look at her in the stands, and I, like, feel like I downed, like, 3 Red Bulls. So it's amazing, and she pushes me in every single way possible, and I'm so incredibly lucky.
I might need to borrow her at Olympic trials or something. Oh, yeah. If it's that motivation.
Yeah.
We had lunch with everyone earlier today. You had a huge entourage down here, and obviously you go to school here in Texas. How many people are here with you? What's it like to have that support?
Oh, gosh. I have such an amazing support system. All of my family here is here, my dad and my mom's side and my coaches, and it's incredible. I feel with my story, I went through a lot, and I wouldn't have made it without the support that I have. So I'm just so blown away by everything and everyone.
Definitely dominated that lunchroom earlier today. But big night ahead. Any last thoughts before you get in there?
You know, I'm just going to relax and have fun because I feel like all the work's been done. So I'm just going to try not to do something stupid, maybe stutter on stage. I don't know. But
and if you do, just play it off.
Okay, yeah, I'll just play it off. I mean, whatever, right? So I'm very excited.
Awesome. Well, best of luck in there tonight, and congrats for being here.
Have fun.
Thank you so much.
Yeah, thanks.
So Demi Payne with those heels.
Yeah, she made us kind of feel really short.
And
now, another tall,
another coming
woman
up from Oregon, Miss Jenna Prandini, after an unbelievable year down here in San Antonio up for this award, and another Oregon athlete. So many of you over the last few years. How's it feel?
It's awesome. It's been a fun time here, and I'm excited for tonight.
Do you think that with the Bowerman Award being named after Bill Bowerman, do you kind of feel like it's Oregon's award to give away or keep?
Bill Bowerman's an awesome guy, and he's a legend for everyone, and he's a legend in this sport, so he's definitely a hometown guy, but I think this award's for everybody.
Ashton, Galen Rupp, Laura Raisler last year have all won this. Have they given you any advice up on stage there?
Laura's been giving me tips here and there, and you know, they put Ashton's when he first got it on display, so it's been in the family for a long time, so I'm just excited to be here.
Well, best of luck in there tonight. Can't wait to see what happens.
So excited. Congratulations.
All right. And we're going to let you step off in there, get seated. And as we get ready for our next group, this is our past winners on the men's side of the Bowerman.
Hello,
and
fellas,
a tall drink of water
dapper
here, Mr. Derek Druin, Mr. Dion Lindor, last year's winner, and Goni Makusha. No, I'd like to stay. How are you guys doing tonight?
Looking great. Thank you, sir.
Who's the most dapper of the crew here tonight? Have you guys discussed this yet?
Derek. You win. You get the flower.
They're all modest. I love it.
Well, guys, how does it feel to be back here? I know you guys have returned a few times for this. How you feel being here again to be a part of it?
It's wonderful. You know, the candidates for this year, they're very good athletes. So to be mentioned, to be in that group, it makes you feel very good. And so I'm happy to be here. Yeah.
Nice. So the most recent is you, of course, right here. So any advice that you may want to give up to the finalists that are going to be coming up here after?
Well, what they need to do is not to look too scared while they're out there, and always have a speech prepared, because you never know who's going to win.
That's good advice.
Derek, most recently you just won a world title, right? A winner of this award on to world title. I know you won a few medals. What was it like winning this and then moving on to that professional career?
Yeah, I mean, if you look at the list of the past winners, it's pretty prestigious. It's pretty nice to be among that group. So, you know, I'm just trying to live up to the name.
I think you've definitely done that.
Any predictions tonight on that men's side?
Don't be shy.
They're all good athletes, and I know whoever they choose is going to be, he deserves it. Whoever on the men's side, on the women's side, they all deserve it. They're all good athletes, and they've done a lot of great stuff last season.
Yeah. Always an unbelievable crew out there. I'm glad I'm not the one that has to open up that envelope. So, guys, thanks so much for being here. Let you guys get in there and have fun in there tonight.
Thank you, guys. Let me give some shakes, too, and then y'all can exit right.
So, with our men's past winners now heading off, that means, Queen, we're going to start filtering in our finalists for this year, and our first one from Akron, Mr. Shawn Barber. Welcome up to the stage here, sir.
Love it. I get all the hugs and the kisses on the cheek.
I just get the handshakes, which I guess is okay, but here you go. How you feeling?
Very good. Yeah, happy to be here.
What's it been like going through this past year, not just in the collegiate season, went on to win a world title as a young guy, beating the world record holder, unbelievable. What stands out for you?
You know, definitely the indoor season was phenomenal for me, and I really couldn't have asked for anything more. But, you know, I think to ask for anything more from the season in general would be taking too much. I was very happy with everything that happened, and, looking back, it's all good memories.
Now the work is all the way done. Of course, now you can just relax. Do you feel comfortable going in with your chances? You won the fan vote, which was a huge thing. Are you excited? Are you confident on the win in here as you have been in the pole vault?
I'm comfortable, not confident. I think that there's between the two other guys, there's a lot of great talent in the room. So it's really up to anybody.
Modest. I like it. I like it. Humble.
Well, Shawn, best of luck out there tonight. Definitely a crazy group of three athletes out there, so excited to see what happens. Thanks so much.
We'll see you inside.
So we're going to call our next athlete up, and we've seen plenty of Oregon athletes so far. We're going to call another one up, Mr. Edward Cheserek. Edward, welcome back.
How you doing?
And the only returner from last year's finalists. What's it like to be back for year number two?
I think it's amazing to be back here again for the second time.
How are you feeling about the competition this year for the award compared to what it was last year?
I think this year is a little tougher because these guys are really, really good, amazing athletes. And, we'll see who is going to take it.
Is there a little more pressure being that you're a returner? This is your second year. Is a little more pressure for you to go home with the Bowerman, or is it easy breezy?
I think it's a lot of pressure. Not even a little. It's a lot of pressure, coming here for the second time. And, we'll see who's going to take it.
Well, you're definitely deserving in addition to all the finalists, and it's really great to have you back here.
Thank you.
Edward, best of luck out there tonight. Thanks so much.
This way, right?
So that was Edward Cheserek and our finalist.
Final finalist.
On the men's side.
With the bow tie. Okay, we have Marquis Dendy. How you doing?
Doing very well.
Looking good.
Thank you very much.
All right, I like the pink shirt.
Thank you.
So what's it feel like to finally be here after an amazing year that you had?
It feels amazing. Like, I really can't fathom all this stuff happening for, little old me. It just means so much to me. I got a big smile on my face.
It's only the beginning. You had a great season at the NCAA level, and then post-collegiate you went and ran and jumped in the Diamond Leagues. How do you feel going into the professional rankings now and getting out of the whole NCAA system?
It feels really good. Traveling is something I got to get used to. I didn't know the whole packing system. I used to pack. I actually underpacked for all my meets, and that's not a good idea. So now I kind of know how to pack for late fees. Diamond League meets and kind of traveling here and there, so it's definitely a good learning experience.
Pack snacks. That'll be my tidbit to you because you never know what there'll be to eat out there. Yeah.
Now I want to know how many things you packed for when you're filtering through what you're going to wear tonight. Did you pick one tie? Did you know the big bow tie was going to be it, or did you have a few options?
I actually forgot everything. I had to go buy everything. So because I'm packing to actually go home too. So I forgot my entire outfit. So this is kind of all on the fly. So me and my mom did a good job getting this together. So
y'all pieced it together.
Job. Yeah. Y'all did a good job putting it together.
Any last thoughts before you go in there and get ready for this thing?
Nothing but go Gators. That's all I got to say. So that's it. Thank you.
Cool. Well, Marquis, best of luck out there. It's going to be a great show.
Good luck. All the work is already done.
So that's our crew right there. That's our past finalists, our current finalists. What'd you think? What'd you see out there?
Man, it's a lot of personality. I think they were kind of put on the spot by the bright light. But I'm excited to see who's going to win. I didn't feel too many sweaty armpits when I was hugging them. So they're not as nervous as I probably was. But I'm excited to see who's going to win.
Yeah, talk about those nerves a little bit. When you walk through after this red carpet, you go sit down. You're kind of just waiting. You got about an hour. What's going through your mind, and how important has this award become?
You know, the craziest thing is we never get to see track athletes outside of their workout clothes. So I think it's a little more nerve-wracking of what you're going to wear off of the track, no spikes, than it is to actually sit and wait. Because at the end of the day, anyone that's in here, the top six, we all know we're more than deserving. So at the end of the day, it just comes down to whose day is it. And so the nerves have to be out the window because you've put in all the work. So.
I want to ask you, as a past winner, you win this award. It kind of puts another accolade under your belt there. And some might say a little pressure, you know, as you move on, you know, the kind of the eyes are on you. How was it for you as you moved on to that professional career?
Oh, man, especially now. I mean, every year the Bowerman Award is becoming even more prestigious and even more people know about it. So now when you throw around the title of you're the Bowerman winner and you're on the line, people kind of look at you like, oh, you think you're all that? Okay, well, let me bring my A game. So it definitely adds a level of pressure and a higher level of expectation. But everyone in here, they obviously can rise to the occasion when there's a lot of pressure. So this is no different. They'll be ready for the next level.
We've seen you all do it multiple times. So
exactly.
Well, that's it from the red carpet. We are going to get ready for the show to start at 7 p.m. with our host, Mr. John Anderson. So thank you all for watching, and we'll be back with you in just a few minutes.
See you inside.
Make a love all night. First you're up, then you're down, and in between. Oh, I really wanna know, what do you mean?
Tomorrow, Mona, and I've got that little something I like. the little something I've been wanting to borrow. Tonight's the night, come on, surrender. I won't lead your love astray. Astray, yeah. Your love's a weapon, give your body some direction. That's my aim. Then we could take back the night. Come on, use me up until there's nothing left. Take back the night. Dizzy, spinning, sweating, you can't catch your breath. Glass and let's take back the night, take back the night, they gon' try to shut us down, but I'll be damned if we gon' let them. Take back the night, take back the night, ooh, you know you gon' mess around and find out there ain't no one better. Take back the night, not too many, no one but you in crowded rooms. We can do anything. Attraction can drive you crazy, and the way you're moving, you go crazy. That's incentive for me. Wanna do something right, yeah, but we could do something better. There ain't no time like tonight, and we ain't trying to save it for later. Stay out here living the life, nobody cares who we are tomorrow. Got that little something I like, that little something I've been wanting to borrow. Tonight's the night, come on, surrender. I won't lead your love astray, astray.
like a diamond. Shine bright like a diamond. Find light in the beautiful sea. I chose to be happy. You and I, we're like diamonds in the sky. You're a shooting star I see, a vision of ecstasy. When you hold me, I'm alive. We're like diamonds in the sky.
Ladies and gentlemen, please find your seats. Your program is about to begin.
Shining bright like a diamond.
We're beautiful like diamonds in the sky.
Shine bright like a diamond. Shine bright like a diamond. Shining bright like a diamond.
We're beautiful like diamonds in the sky.
Palms rise to the universe as we moonshine and Mali. Feel the warmth, we'll never die. We're like diamonds. Sky, you're a shooting star I see, a vision of ecstasy. When you hold me, I'm alive. We're like diamonds in the sky. At first sight, I felt the energy of sunrise. I saw the life inside you. Shine bright tonight, you and I. We're beautiful.
Ladies and gentlemen, please find your seats. Your program will begin momentarily.
Shine bright like a diamond. Shine bright like a diamond. Shine bright like a diamond. So shine bright.
Shine bright like a diamond. Shine bright like a diamond. Shine bright like a diamond. Oh.
was his third and final attempt at a new collegiate record, 19-4 in 3 quarters. And look at how easy he clears there. It's going to be Prandini at the line. 10 points for Oregon.
And a standing room only crowd gives a full-throated roar. Look at that. And he gets out 58 feet, 1 1/4 inch. It's a sensational jump. Now the bar gets moved up to 15 feet, 5 inches. This is Demi's attempt. Wow, plenty of room to spare.
And now here comes Kenny Harrison, as he does win the title.
55, outstanding time. What a future this woman has, Kenny Harrison. Cheserek, who hung with him, just pulled away. The man seems bionic. He absolutely does.
Good evening and welcome to the JW Marriott Hill Country here in San Antonio for the 2015 presentation of the Bowerman. Please give a warm welcome to a man who's now been with us for 4 years of this award, ESPN SportsCenter anchor, Mr. John Anderson.
The envelopes are right there. I could get this whole thing over in like 30 seconds. No? Do the whole thing? Okay. A lot of people put a lot of time in this, so I guess we'll go through the whole bit. Oh, my goodness. Well, thank you and hello again. I appreciate your applause. You are wonderful. I will try to live up to that warm greeting. I don't know if I can do that. I am as tired as all get out. I left to get here at 4 a.m. this morning, and that was just from my room here at the Marriott. This is a fantastic night. It is a celebration. We are here at the Bowerman Awards. It is the annual honoring of the finest collegiate track and field athletes in the nation, which of course begs the question, what the hell am I doing here? I mean, I am over my head by a lot. I look at this room, and there are a lot of you, which is frightening. World-class athletes, they're Hall of Fame coaches, loving family members, Sam Seams, there's Sam, and Ryan Fenton's beard. I am not in the class of any of those people, and I would like to tell you that this joke, when I wrote it earlier this week, was hilariously funny. And I walk in, and I see Fenton has joined the Dollar Shave Club for Men. Can you believe that? Oh no, it's a big event, I gotta look good. All right, whatever, why start tonight? But anyway, I am pleased to share the workload with Ryan from Flow Track. And by the way, since Clemson doesn't play until New Year's Eve, I think we have his full attention all evening, which is fantastic. We will press on despite the beer jokes. A warm holiday greeting to everyone here. We wanna welcome everybody who is watching on Flow Track, Ryan's group, via the interwebs, and then also, this year on the Coaches Association's website, www.USTFCCCA. Sam, WTF, brother, what is that? Right? I'm 50. What, WTF, right? Why the long face? Or why the face? I don't know. Like, you need to tighten that up. I don't know if you just dumped out a Scrabble box and went, hey, yeah, that looks good. What the hell? Look, 17 points. I actually checked this out. Words with friends. You can spell cactus, but you got like the F and the C left over. It doesn't do much for you. It is a treat for me to be here again. I can be and share in the fellowship of so many people that love track and field. It is also the one time a year I can use the term thin clad without having to go to HR. I also get to be reminded of how truly a middling athlete I was in this sports. Like, you guys in the front row, you guys are the new Star Wars, and I'm like Paul Blart, Mall Cop 3. This is, as Ryan said, the fourth year that I've been asked to host. I am pleased with that. The only problem is I ran out of like jokes about my career in year two. So in the absence of actual ability, what I usually do then is I make a joke about Sam Seams not paying me, right? That's sort of my thing. But even he has gotten on with that whole full cost of attendance deal, and tonight I get to eat at the dinner afterwards. But Sam, I say this to you seriously, truly. You are kind to have me. I am grateful, and I thank you. Don't ever think that I take this for granted. This is a special night for me, as it is for everyone else here, and I appreciate all that you've helped create with this award. And it's a pleasure for me to be a part of it. Thank you. Now, Sam will always flatter me with praise and compliments when he tries to recruit me to come back, and I am not fooled in the least. Okay? A few weeks after my last stint hosting the Bowermans 2 years ago, I received a note in my mailbox at ESPN critiquing my work at the Bowermans, right? Now, ordinarily, mail, that's a good thing, right? Well, early on at ESPN, I learned a valuable lesson from Dan Patrick, right? Legendary Dan Patrick, everybody knows Dan. And he said, listen, if you get something from someone you don't know, what you do is you start reading at the bottom, okay? Especially if it's from like a correctional facility. And if it says sincerely or thanks or respectfully, something like that, then you go to the top and you read the rest of it, okay? If it ends die or quit or go to hell, you SOB, and you throw it out, okay? Well, on this day, the letter's closing is much appreciated, and then it had the guy's name, Bill something or other. All right, up to the top we're going. This is great. I have transcribed this. Dear John, watched the Bowerman Awards show in its entirety the other day and was surprised to learn you were just an average college high jumper. I had you pegged as a first-rate distance runner. Okay? I feel great. We're reading on. I had you pegged as a first-rate distance runner. Next line, because you look like you were in pain while you made everybody else in the ballroom suffer. Please quit, die, and go to hell, you SOB. Much appreciated, Bill something or other. So I am here tonight with my confidence shaken a bit. Athletically, I know it's truly over. My 13-year-old son and I ran a 5K in September, and generally when a sportscaster says, I got beat by a mile, that's hyperbole. I got beat by a mile. Okay? This kid's munching an apple at the end, and I'm at the 2-mile water station. I mention this because what I'd like to do now is shine a light on all the parents and the grandparents and the caregivers and the family of our 6 finalists tonight. So if you all could please stand for a moment and we could recognize you guys for your wonderful children and the wonderful work you've done. Thank you. You deserve to be applauded. More importantly, as you see the products of your parenting, you deserve to be proud. The 6 finalists here are the finest that this sport has to offer in college. Kendra, Demi, Jenna, Shawn, Edward, Marquis. Are we doing these? I thought this was like outdoor nationals. Are we doing the women today and the men tomorrow? Or are we just... It's all tonight. Okay. All right. Sorry. I get confused. It's like, I don't need to remind you all, you are exceptional. You are. Talent, dedication, passion, focus, all of it is to be envied and admired. So a couple of quick things. First, most of you are turning pro, so I would like you to remain pure in your pursuit of excellence. The great distance runner Rod Dixon once said, when you're at the starting line, the last thing you think about is money. And when you're at the finish line, money is the first thing you think about. So at least get to the end. Second, Shawn Barber. You're totally going to win, because whenever I'm here, the guy from Canada wins. Derek, Cam Levins, and then, I don't know, Ashton Eat was an outlier. He got lucky. The Bowerman debuted in 2009. It is presented annually by the Coaches Association. Is that okay if I just shorten it, please? To the most outstanding male and female collegiate track and field athlete in the nation. It is important to note that those of us in the electorate cast their votes based solely on the college track season. So, Chaz, man, you wasted a lot of miles in the fall, brother. But I don't make the rules. Shawn, at World Championship gold, bupkis. You want to give it to me? I can hold it till you're done. Whatever. However, given the history of the award, there will be more medals coming. In 7 years, the kids here in the front row have won 8 Olympic medals, 11 world championships, 4 indoor world championships, and a total of 25 world championship medals. They don't give away. You can take your Heisman, you can take your Golden Spikes Award. There isn't anything else in college that has that kind of track record. So feel free to be impressed as we review the greatness of our past Bowerman winners. Let's welcome our past Bowerman winners. And part of what makes this evening special and unique is that these people keep coming back and returning because winning it is special, and then they're here to help whoever the next year's winner will be. And we certainly enjoy that special recognizes and special. So from 2010, the women's winner, Queen Harrison, representing Virginia Tech. Both of our winners from 2011 are here. Jessica Beard, Texas A&M. Nagoni Makusha from Florida State. 2013 winner, women's winner, Brianna Rollins, Clemson. Are you going to the games? Are you going to go to the semifinal game for football? Are you going to go to the semifinal football game? Okay. If you need tickets, let me know. ESPN, I got some things. 2013 men's winner. I don't hide. I said earlier, I play favorites. Look, it's the high jumper, Derek Druin. Last year's winner then, as you saw here, women's winner Laura Raisler from Oregon. And Dion Lendore, the 2014 men's winner from Texas A&M. Who has not had a haircut since. And now, just in case you forget the winners and you don't have a good view up front, you can just turn around. They're all right back there, forever and ever. Tonight's business, though, we have to figure out who will join this esteemed line of Bowerman champions. And we will begin with our female finalists, and our first one is Kendra Harrison.
When you're the only woman in collegiate history to accomplish something, you know you're doing it right. And fast. Kendra Harrison became the first woman to register a top 5 time in each of the 3 hurdle distances contested at the 2015 NCAA Championships, 60 meters, 100 meters, and 400 meters. She first etched her name in the record books in the 60 meter hurdles at the Indoor Championships with the 3rd fastest time in collegiate history, a blazing 7.87. That race came 2 weeks after she had returned from a hamstring injury and ran away from the field in the same event at the SEC Championship in a meet record 7.92 seconds. The versatile Harrison continued her stellar season outdoor, where she went undefeated in finals of the 100-meter hurdles. She ran her PR of 12.50 at the conference championship. That was the 4th fastest college clocking all time. A month later at the NCAA Championships, she blew away the competition, running 12.55 to claim Kentucky's first ever title in the event.
I think just coming out here competing with everybody, you know, everyone at this level is really good, and, you know, to win such a really high level competition, it means everything.
Harrison nearly marvelous over a full lap. Her runner-up time in the 400-meter hurdles at the national championships, 54.09, that ranks 5th on the all-time list and was 2nd only to eventual world silver medalist Shamir Little. A memorable senior year for a most memorable Wildcat. a 15-time All-America, she is Bowerman finalist Kendra Harrison.
Here's the other part of this night that's great. We don't interview the athletes right when they've finished. So they're going... Okay, so Kendra Harrison, and the first thing I think of, oh, I bet she's related to Kenny Harrison, Kansas State. Yes?
No.
No. Well, we have a Queen Harrison. You're probably related to Queen Harrison.
No.
No. You go to Kentucky, they had Andrew and Aaron, the Harrison twins, right? And you're not related.
No.
Tell me about your family. It's a great story.
Well, I come from a family of 11. Eight of us were adopted. So I got raised in a really big household.
Did you ever have your own room?
No, not until like my senior year in high school.
And you still wanted to go to college? I'd have said, I'm not leaving, Mom and Dad.
Yeah.
Name them.
Okay, starting.
This is like Goodwill Hunting, right? Where he says to the guy, Mickey, Mikey, Tony, Brian.
Okay, ahead. Starting with the youngest. Kara, Kip, Victor, Corey, JoJo, Hyung, Tasha, Gabby, Casey. JoJo.
I'm assuming we just draw names for Santa, right? Because that's a lot of stuff to buy. Tell me about your best day you've ever had on the track.
My best day I ever had on the track was winning my first title, Indoor Nationals in the 60 hurdles.
Okay. Do you have a favorite workout?
No, not really.
Do you have a least favorite workout?
400 hurdle workouts.
Who's responsible for your workouts?
Coach Lowe.
Right over here with Ryan Fenton.
I'm down here with head coach at University of Kentucky, Edric Florial, and Queen Harrison joining us again. Edric, I was at the SEC indoor meet, and during the winter, Kendra was injured, comes back her first meet of the season to run hurdles. She wins the SEC title. 2 weeks later, wins the NCAA title. What did that say about her as an athlete to come back so quickly and win at such a high level?
Well, I mean, I think everybody, when you see that, you assume the athlete was ready to do it and felt confident about doing it. That's not always the truth. Sometimes you got to get a little coercing and a little encouraging. It took a little bit of that, and I think once we got past the prelims, it was evident that we were into something special.
Now, we all know the 100-meter hurdles and the 400-meter hurdles are two totally different beasts. I know, especially if you're in the duo hurdler. Is there a certain mindset or something that you all focus on so that she can participate in both of them on the same day in the same championship?
Well, we focus on being just like Queen, and that worked out pretty well for us.
Don't flatter me.
Well, no. I mean, the cool thing is, like, this year, the championships was the 100-meter hurdles and the 400-meter hurdles were back-to-back 45 minutes apart. And we had to sort of develop a strategy so she can go back and forth between both of them. So we actually worked out on the 100-meter hurdles and then took 20 minutes of rest and actually did a 400-meter hurdle workout. And that, you know, that was probably one of my best ideas, but it ended up working out because it helped her make the transition from stride reduction to stride enlargement.
Did she hate you after that?
I think she still hates me.
Okay, I understand.
Well, things seem to work out this past year, and we're excited to see how it goes tonight. John, back up to you.
I hate Coach. Nothing, you just feel the love in the room when that kind of thing happens. I didn't really tell you this at rehearsal, but I like to check the Twitter. I am officially not small. Gained 7 pounds. Are you fat shaming people? What's going on here?
No, over the years, you know, I can't really gain a lot of weight, but, you know, I made that my number one priority this year, going on to the next level. So, you know, gaining more muscle is going to make me have more power and that kind of thing.
Okay, this is your last big night as a college track athlete, so tell me before we let you go about the future. What's the summer and perhaps Rio mean to you?
Well, I run for Adidas now, and I'm going to try out for the indoor worlds, and outdoor, I'm going to go out for the Olympics.
Best of luck to you, Kendra Harrison.
Thank you.
After every championship she won and every record she set, Stephen F. Austin Jr. pole vaulter Demi Payne wanted the world to know she was doing it all for her 2-year-old daughter, Charlie.
It's been such a hard journey, and even on that last attempt at 15-7, I'm like, all right, let's bring this home for Charlie. I want this for her.
With a new supporter by her side, a determined Payne honed her focus like never before and set out to make 2015 a year to remember. In just her second meet back after taking a year off from competition, she put the nation on notice when she surpassed the previous indoor collegiate record with a vault of 15-2 and a quarter at the Texas A&M Invitational. The following week at the Lobo Invitational in Albuquerque, she broke her own record two more times. Her first vault pushed the record to 15-3, and then she raised it another 4 inches to an astounding 15-7. All the while, a rivalry for the ages was brewing with Arkansas's Sandy Morris. The duo traded the outdoor collegiate record twice, with Morris ultimately owning the mark. But at the NCAA's in Eugene, Payne took flight, landing in the pit and atop the podium. She didn't miss an attempt in winning the crown and set a meet record 15 feet 5 inches. Incredibly, that was one of 9 clears of 15 feet or better for Payne this year. She is a mother and a champion, and now a Bowerman finalist. Demi Payne of Stephen F. Austin.
Well, you have the home field advantage.
Yes, I know. My family is pretty big out there.
Do you want to talk about track first or motherhood first?
Either one. Let's go.
You pick.
We can talk about being a mom.
Okay. Is the house ready for Santa?
Yes.
Yeah?
It's decorated, yeah.
You have 7 days. Is your shopping done?
No. Only because, like, I don't know. I feel like at this age, like, my parents can take care of the presents for her. Because they don't give presents to me anymore. They just give them to her, so.
Right, and once you have the grandchild, right, you're just like, whatever.
Yeah, I'm like, hey, Mom, I'm coming home. And she's like, are you bringing Charlie? Okay, love you too.
Well, where are your folks? There they are. This is just, trampolines are cool. Ice cream is awesome. That's all I'm going to say. Give us what the balancing act is like between baby and track and school and all those things at once.
Yeah, it's really difficult, you know, and I think I try to make it seem like it's not that hard, but it really is. I think every day there's a new struggle, and I think what helps me is that I don't get caught up. Like, if something goes wrong, I'm like, all right, it's fine, let's tackle the next thing. And I don't know, it helps having somebody looking at you all the time, and I want to do so good for her. For that little girl, like, I want to do big things, so she motivates me.
That's balancing those couple, three things. What about just the balance the child brings to your life, right? You come home and we have a horrible workout or whatever, and you look and she didn't care. She thinks you're awesome.
Yeah, I know. That's where I feel like, I don't know, I have like an advantage over athletes in college. Like, a lot of them don't have kids and they don't get to come home to that kind of thing. And I do, and I'm like, gosh, like, God's got me. He did all this for a reason, so.
So you have the baby, and then you took, what, a couple months off? Mm-hmm. You went to work 4 days later, is what I read.
Yeah. My dad had me back on the runway 4 days after I had Charlie. Probably not the best idea. Don't tell my doctor that.
I don't know. We're going to find out if your coach had anything to do with this. Ryan?
Yeah, we're down here with head coach at Stephen F. Austin, Phil Olson, and the women's pole vault this year was unbelievable. The back and forth between Demi and Sandy Morris at Arkansas. Every week, records broken by one or the other, wins traded off. What was it like as a coaching staff to go through that, and how did Demi handle that?
Just unbelievably amazing, humbling, and just to watch her week in, week out, day in, day out, do something great. And I think Demi would be the first person in this room to thank Sandy Morris for the competitive level that they went to this year. It's just unbelievable. Who was gonna set the record next? And so, God bless Sandy Morris and her battles with Demi over the course of the season. It was amazing.
Was. It's safe to say the majority of us in here have been student athletes to some capacity, but to also throw in the motherhood in the pot, what do you see what did you see day in and day out that was special in Demi for her to be able to pull off three important jobs like that at the same time?
Well, balance obviously was the issue, and she just had to balance her life out
We encouraged Demi to bring Charlie to team meetings, any team function that we had, our Christmas dinner, Charlie was there. And we also gave Demi a lot of free passes. You get a free pass if we have a team meeting and Charlie needs you, and Thomas, Demi's fiance, you get a free pass, you get to go home. And I think, Demi, we've done a pretty good job of that, have we not? Yeah.
It was a collaborative effort. I love that.
Definitely a special year, a special athlete. And John, I want to know, can you juggle three things like that?
No. Mm-mm. No. No. If I had those three, I'd just be sitting on a couch eating pudding. I'd have no shot. We showed that you went to outdoor nationals and you didn't miss a height, okay? Indoor nationals, you didn't make a height. How did the first one affect the second one?
Gosh, okay, so indoor nationals, it was the biggest letdown ever. And, you know, I had such an amazing first half of indoor, and so I was like, all right, I'm gonna go into indoor and just kill it, and I end up no hiding. And it was a really big disappointment, and I felt like it was more of a disappointment for everyone else because they expected to see a battle, and mm-hmm. I totally let them down on my part. So going into outdoor, I was like, all right, this is my last chance. Like, I have something to prove, and I want people to see that I can perform at a big meet, and I can blow it up. So I wasn't gonna let anybody stop me or get in my way. I was totally zoned in to what I wanted.
And now, the third highest vaulter of all time, the other two in the U.S. have gold medals. So no pressure there, I just wanted to mention. you have Twitter too. So I you need to stand up, if you would, please.
Oh my gosh, okay.
No. Just spent my life savings on a dress for the Bowerman ceremony. You look lovely, Demi Payne.
Thank you.
Our next finalist is Jenna Prandini.
Oregon's Jenna Prandini was a green and yellow blur, both on the track and in the field in 2015, posting historic marks and point totals matched by few before her. So let's just break out the calculator and add them up. Start with NCAA indoors, where she soared to a 21-10 win in the long jump, 5 inches farther than the runner-up. That's 10 points there. Picked up 5 more points in the 60 with a 4th place finish, and topped it off by scoring 8 points, taking 2nd in the 200. Grand total, 23 points, the most in the meet since 2003. In Eugene, she competed 7 times in 4 events during a 2-day stretch. That's more glory and gaudy point total. In the 100, she outleaned a talented field to win the event for 10 points. It then took Kentucky's Desiree Bryant running the 2nd fastest time in collegiate history to stop Prandini at 200. Still, that's 8 more. Those impressive results came less than 48 hours after she took 2nd in the long jump with one of the longest leaps in meet history.
You've basically been a heptathlete out here in all these individual events. How are you juggling all this?
I'm just staying focused, taking it event by event, and really listening to my coaches and trusting everything that they say.
All told, Prandini recorded 26 points en route to Oregon's title triumph. Only 2 other women scored more points in a single outdoor championship. 3-time Olympic champ Gail Devers and 9-time Olympic medalist Merline Otte. That is select and famous company to be sure. No female athlete in recent memory successfully combined track with field. Then her, she is Bowerman finalist Jenna Prandini.
By the way, 26 points at Nationals, you would have tied for 11th with LSU. That's not terrible. 100, 200, relays, long jump. Do you think maybe you should let some of the other kids participate?
They all participated. They all did it with me.
Okay. If you do all that, why don't you do like the heptathlon? That seems like that'd be fun. Throw in a few more.
Because in the heptathlon, you can only get 10 points. But if you do them individually, you can get more.
See, that's teamwork right there. I love that answer. If I said you only get to have one event, what would it be?
Ooh. I don't know. People ask me that all the time. And
I'm just the latest in the line.
I think I switch my answer every time. they're both... The sprints and the jumps are so different. I can't really compare them. But
I don't know, the 100, 200 long jump?
That's... Yeah, listen, you can cop out. I have no problem with that whatsoever. How many people do you have here tonight?
Just my parents are here tonight.
Okay. How many people came to Nationals?
I couldn't even tell you how many. They drove up from California in trailers and had Go Jenna Go shirts, so.
I read 48.
Yeah, that okay. Sounds right.
Since I did this to Kendra, it's only fair to you. Name them. No. You went to U.S. Nationals, you won the 200s, and I read your dad said he cried. You're a bad daughter. You made your dad cry.
I know. He never cries.
Well, that's because they're just effusive with pride. Best thing about being an Oregon Duck?
Ooh, there's a lot of things. I think just having an overall, just having a great team and being a part of a team where everyone's so good. I just love being with my teammates and having, what I think the best coaches in the nation. So it's all the best stuff.
That, my friends, is a segue to the best coaches. Ryan.
We're down here with Jenna's coach, Curtis Taylor, and unbelievable year. A lot of people might not know she was injured midway through the outdoor season, in the hunt where you guys are trying to win your first women's title in 30 years. She comes back, scores the 26 points, becomes the fastest woman in the NCAA. What was that like watching her come back to help her team?
Well, it was a little nerve-wracking in the beginning because, we weren't sure she was going to be able to make it back to the level. She ran so well early on. But, knowing the kind of person she is and her work ethic, we figured she would make it back. So she surprised us and then some.
She definitely has a very distinctive work ethic. So she does all these events. Now she's post-collegiate, so we're not worried about the point system. Any heptathlons in the future?
You'd have to ask her about it. She'd probably say no, but...
Well, if y'all plan on coming to the hurdles, just let me know ahead of time.
I will. I'll let you know expressly.
All right.
Try not to scare Queen here. John, back up to you guys.
They mentioned post-collegiate. If you could, can you tell the difference as you go through a meet if you're in a Nationals or a U.S. Nationals or a World Championship? How does that change as you go along that scale?
I guess at NCAA Nationals, everything I was doing was for the team. I just wanted to score a lot of points. Mm-hmm. And coming to Oregon, my main goal was to win a national championship as a team. So that was my focus there. And then going into USA's, Curtis just told me to have fun. And so that's what I did, was step on the line to have fun.
Mm-hmm. And Beijing?
Beijing, that was crazy there. The bird's nest, I've just seen it on TV. And to be able to go and compete there was incredible. And it was an amazing experience.
Okay, I made a quick joke earlier in the day, and I said, oh, you have a billion different uniforms. She goes, no, we just have one. Look around. One, two, that's at least three different ones.
I mean, we do have a lot. We just don't use them all.
You do have a lot. Bowerman finalist Jenna Prandini. Excuse me. And now we go back to Ryan. You want to talk about a rose amongst the thorn, or the thorn amongst the rose. Excuse me. He's there with our past champions.
Lucky man down here. Yes, past champions, four of them. And Laura, you were the most recent champion last year. What was it like when they opened the envelope, said your name? What were those emotions? Do you remember?
I'm pretty sure I swore. And you could see my mouth moving. But I was just really surprised. I wasn't expecting it. All the finalists were so amazing. So, just felt really lucky and blessed and just to be here, so.
And thankfully you weren't mic'd up at the time, so, right. Jess, 4 years ago when you won, what do you remember about sitting out here in this crowd, everyone kind of eyes on you and waiting to see what was gonna happen?
I just remember my heart beating really fast. I'm like, come on. I feel like he's like, and the winner is. I was like, oh, please say something. So, just overwhelming emotions and just hoping that he called my name, so.
Brian Rollins, what was it like winning this award, and how did it set you off going on to your professional career?
It was a blessing. Is it on? Oh. It was a blessing. I had the opportunity to be able to come out here and to receive the award. I was very thankful that I could have the accomplishment.
And Queen, you've been here a few times with us, and I think the I don't want to say the elder of the group here,
Yeah, watch your mouth.
Yeah. 2010 champion, though. What's it like been for you to see this award evolve over these past 6 years?
Oh, it's amazing. Every single year it gets bigger, it's larger, more people tune in, and it's a prestigious award. It was in 09, and it still is now, but even more people are recognizing it. So I'm just so excited to be a part of it and be amongst this elite group of girls and guys and two more tonight.
Speaking of two more, it's time to announce one of those, so we're going to send it up to Alfreda Goff to find out who the women's champion is tonight.
Thank you, and good evening. Before I make the announcement, and I'm not going to drag this out, but I do want to acknowledge all of the coaches that are in the room that have spent many, many hours, many, many years in developing some of the finest young men and young women, not just the six that are in this room, but the thousands of student athletes that you impact every day with your wisdom, your time, and believe me, I understand as a former track and field coach, sometimes your frustrations. So thank you, track and field coaches, for all of our colleges. It is my privilege to announce the Bowerman 2015 women's winner, Jenna Prandini.
Wow, this is amazing. First, I want to congratulate Kenny and Demi. I wish my name was Jenny, because then it would all go together. But you guys are amazing, and you had such awesome seasons, and it's an honor to be here with you. To my coaches, thank you for believing in me and pushing me each and every day. And I mean, I wouldn't be standing up here if it weren't for you guys. You brought me and made me into an athlete I never thought I could be, so thank you. to my teammates and my training partners, I'm here because of you guys. You pushed me every single day and made practice fun, and I'm very thankful for that. And to my parents, mom, dad, my brother, my sister, and everybody else, there's so many of them, thank you for supporting me. Ever since I was little, they've been by my side through the good and the bad, and I couldn't say enough about them. So thank you very much, and thank you to the Bowerman.
These right now are kind of for show only. They get the real one will be mailed to them. It's just if you want it before Christmas, you're going to have to pay the added shipping. So I don't know what that's going to go. Congratulations, Jenna. And now it's on to present the men's award, because we are doing that tonight again, right, Sam? Not tomorrow? We're good? All right. Shawn Barber, you're up.
Whenever Akron Shawn Barber brings his poles to a meet, the competition is for second. His first place is already taken. Barber, relentless in his pursuit of excellence in 2015, as he went a staggering 15-1 in the event, with the lone loss coming when the bar beat him, a no-height outdoor. Nine of his wins came indoor, where he put on a record-breaking clinic. Barber shattered a 16-year-old collegiate record in his fourth meet of the season and raised the bar twice more after that. His meet record, 19-4¾ at the NCAAs, is the best vault ever by a collegian indoor. And he ended the season with more 19 feet clearances, 10 of them, than all other collegians in history combined.
I came in a lot more physically fit and a lot more mentally prepared for the season compared to last year. I think that's really carried over to some good performances.
Even the Olympic champion and world record holder couldn't match Barber undercover. During the Drake relays in April, weather moved the event inside, and Barber soared over a meet record of 19 feet 1 inch to beat London gold medalist Renaud Lavanie of France. Barber equally impressive when the sun shone and he got outdoors. He twice eclipsed 19.4. Trivia, both times in the state of Texas. Then in Oregon, Barber won his first outdoor title to complete an NCAA championship streak. After putting that bow on his collegiate career, Barber turned his attention to the global stage, where he became the first collegian and first Canadian to win world championship gold in the pole vault, again besting Lavanie. The year of the Barber in the pole vault. Here is Bowerman finalist Shawn Barber.
Wow. We were talking during that presentation. I'm like, if you watch the pole vault, if you're a kid, like, there's no more, there can't be a funner event, right? I mean, I'm enthralled. I want to do that. What's it like for you?
For me, it's exactly that. It's the funnest thing I could do. It's been a great pastime for me, and I couldn't picture myself doing anything else.
We mentioned you two great jumps, a series of jumps when you were here in Texas, right? And right. You were born where?
I was born in New Mexico.
Okay, and you were raised here.
About sixth grade or so.
Okay.
And I had the pleasure to spend a little time in Canada as well, so that's kind of
right. How does that make you Wayne Gretzky all of a sudden, that you're jumping for Canada?
Who knows?
Do you ever have the urge to go curling?
You know, it's never been something that I found the need to do.
Okay, I didn't know. Derek, do you ever curl? No.
Not once.
We're going to have to see if you guys are the legit thing. That's all I'm going to say. What is a zip? The Akron Zips.
A zip is a kangaroo.
Oh, well, see, that's perfect. You just go bouncing around.
That's right.
They just go up the hind legs, but that's not too bad. All these wins, and I realize the World Championship's we're going to set that aside for a minute because it's a different thing. Your favorite one from college?
My favorite win from college was definitely NCAA Outdoors. It was something that I hadn't done before, and it was something that was definitely an important part of my collegiate career and a big stepping stone for me going pro. It's really upsetting that I didn't jump as well as I'd like to after having pole issues at the meet and different things. But it's one of those meets that you came in feeling great and you thought you were ready to go and really do something special, but unfortunately it just didn't come about.
Pole issue, translation, he broke it. That's why he can't have nice things, I guess. How do you come back from that? Because clearly that throws a wrench in your day.
Yeah, it does. And I think everybody deals with it differently. And I was able to take a step back and understand the situation and realize I still had a job to do. And, just come out and put on a show for the crowd.
Very good. We're going to hear what your coach has to say, because I'm sure he had a little small part in this, right? Sure. Ryan?
We're down on the floor with Dennis Mitchell, the head coach at University of Akron. And Shawn had such a dominant year. But throughout all those performances, was there a time where you remember thinking, he's not going to be beat, this is it, this is his year?
Well, really, even right from the very first time I ever met him, I said, boy, this is something extraordinary. This is a great person. Every day you sit out there with him, even in practice, you say, he's got some special gifts, and especially, the mind he has for the event and how he's able to understand it and be able to work the things out so he can jump real high. You knew at one point he was going to be something extraordinary.
Wow. That. So basically, Shawn, he not only won the Drake relays, but he beat the world record holder on two different occasions, correct?
Right.
So how do you keep from translating from the NCAA mindset of being cool, calm, and collective going into those meets and translate to the international stage, aka world championships?
Well, again, it's the same thing. You got to still put the pole in the box and, get those big jumps. And that's one of the things he is, too. Not only does he have a great mind for the event, but he's a cool, calm customer, and he's able to really handle those competitions well.
I can see with his interviews on stage, pretty cool and calm and level-headed.
He stays composed up there. And, John, back up to you.
How do you stay composed when you're standing there and they put a gold medal around your neck and they play your national anthem?
It's not like it's happened a whole lot of times, so I haven't really learned how to experience it and really deal with that. But I guess you learn from the people before you, and of course I have excellent uh, excellent.
Can people. You describe what the emotions were like for that, though, as you stand up there and you hear it? It's a great national anthem to begin with.
It's wonderful. It's everything you ever dream about as a kid. You know, when you think about competing on that world stage, it's less focus on the event itself. It's more focus on being somewhere on that podium.
Okay, we're gonna have fun with the metric system. What is 5.93 in feet and inches?
In feet and inches, that is like 19 feet 5.5.
Good, that's your PR. Like it. 6 meters.
It's 19.8 and a little bit of change.
A quarter.
And a quarter.
They don't write
a
little
change.
Bit of change.
That's change.
When was the last time you looked at a record book and put a little bit of change? 6.10 meters.
That's 20 feet.
20 feet. And then the final one, 6.16.
That's the world record. 20 feet 2 and some change.
Some change. Some change. Totally. A half. So we just want to make sure you have something to shoot for.
Absolutely.
Shawn Barber, everybody.
Edward Cheserek, we meet again. For the second straight year, King Chez is a Bowerman finalist and ruler of all he surveys in college distance running. After continuing his cross-country reign with yet another crown, the Oregon sophomore attacked the track, where he imposed his will at every distance. His indoor season included 3 sub-4-minute mile races that helped build the drama for a climactic NCAA final. Cheserek actually entered that race in unfamiliar territory, an underdog behind national mile leader Christian Serratos of Montana State. Both men ran sub-4 in qualifying. Then in the championship showdown, Serratos made a big move to challenge the King's rule. But if you come at the King, you best not miss. Cheserek turned on the Jets and kicked past Serratos on the final lap, beating him to the wire by nearly 2 seconds. His indoor mile win headlined a weekend that also included a runner-up finish at 3,000 meters to teammate Eric Jenkins and a blistering anchor leg for the title-winning distance medley relay team and a second straight team crown for the men of Oregon.
King Cheserek, how much fun is that for you?
It's really fun, you know, come here today and just try to score as high a point as I can for my team, you know, try to help my team to defend the title again.
3 months later, Cheserek continued his NCAA winning ways during the outdoor championships at Hayward Field. In front of his home crowd, he doubled up with titles at 5K and again at 10K to lead the Ducks to the top of the podium and a second consecutive team title. A crowning achievement for an all-time great. Long live the King, Bowerman finalist Edward Cheserek.
Do you even have room for one of those things? I mean, all the stuff you've already won?
I think I might have a room. Where it's like, if you go to my place, I just like send a lot to my mom, and whatever left, I just tuck it in box and put it inside in my house.
Okay, I just want to make sure. I mean, if you don't have room for it, we'll give it to somebody who, you know, really wants it. Saw you winning the 5,000 coming down there at Hayward Field. Describe what that was like with the crowd and everybody in those last few meters.
It means a lot, you know. Running in Hayward Field is really, really like the supporters come from Track Town USA, and people around there, they were a big fan of the Track Town USA, and also like people who are like trying like come to support us, and I have classmates there, teammates, and people who knows me mostly over there, and all the time when I'm in class with my fellow students, they ask me like, oh, when are you racing again? I'm like, I have NCAA in 2 days. So it was like, oh, we'll be there supporting you. And after winning that 5K, so I saw a lot of classmates, a lot of athletes came down there to support us. And being there winning the race, it means a lot because it's so crowded and the fans there is so amazing.
Your classmates and your friend, do they call you King? King Chess?
Yeah, when I walk around the campus, they recognize me and they always, oh, I saw King.
You know, we have a queen right over there.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. I'm just saying, we got a whole royal family if we want to go that way. I was not here last year, but I watched Ryan, and he talked to you about taking the exams so that you could get in to your prep school in New Jersey. And I know we're kind of running over some old ground, but I would love for you to tell us again about that day, and the roads are washed out, you can't go, and you decide, I'm going to run to school that day.
It was actually I did for sure, but it's long story, man. Like, so it was I came home from school. I was by that time I was a freshman in high school, and it was we went home for like spring break, and it was so rainy, like raining season over there, and I came home for 2 days, and I asked my dad, like, Dad, can I get a ride to school? I have exams on Monday, and my dad was like, sure, but I'm not sure if the rain can stop. So we waited for, it was on Saturday, we waited until like Saturday in the afternoon-ish. So I told him again, like, Dad, are you gonna try to take me tomorrow? He was like, you know, you see the road, I can't even get the car in the house, so it's so messed up.
So you gotta run.
I make him actually call my teacher like to reschedule my exam so I can take the next day when I get there or a week later. And my teacher was like, we can't do that. So,
no pass from a professor, ain't that just the way?
Yeah. And the good option, like, so I talked to my, we were having dinner in the house, that was Saturday night, and I told my mom and my daddy, like, we're sitting at a table having dinner together. I asked them, like, hey, so how can I get to school tomorrow? Because I need to pass those exams so that I can, you know, move on in life. And daddy was like, we can't do anything about it, so I'm sorry, but I'll talk to the DJ again. And the DJ was just like, tough guy, he didn't give us exams later. So I went to my room and tried to put my two books that I have, it was chemistry and biology. I put in my backpack and come back and talk to my mom because my dad left to his room. I talked to my mom like, hey mom, I think I'll go to school tomorrow morning. He was like, oh, how can you get there? I was like, you know, I'll figure it out to get there. So long as I told you, when I get up in the morning, I just go. He was like, no. He went to talk to my dad, and my dad come out again. I was like, what are you saying? Are you going to go to school tomorrow? I was like, yeah, that's what I was thinking. Like, just, you know, take shortcuts, you know, like, just run.
Just run.
Yeah. So after that, he was like, no. So I went back to my room, put my wallet on my back and my two books and get my running shoes and my dress pants and my shirt. And I slept like 3 hours. And then after that, I was like, oh, I think it's time. I set my alarm. 4 a.m. in the morning. So I try over there, like try to find like something to eat before I leave. Mm-hmm. And I find a bread and juice, a little bit, I drink juice, and then I was like, okay, it's time. So I didn't wake anybody up, I just get out 5 o'clock, start walking. So I walk like 30 minutes before that, and then I was like, it's getting like bright outside, a little bit was too dark. And then after that, I start jogging now. I ran all the way to school. But before that, I was making a lot of stops on the way to just get a water, mm-hmm. sip of water on the river, and then keep moving again. When I get tired, I walk. And then it gets like lunchtime. I stop at a certain restaurant, just get something to eat, because I have my money. And then I eat and then just walk for another 30 minutes. And I keep walking, and then when I get tired, I just sit on the floor and just start reading. So I try to study for the tomorrow finals. So and then after that, I spent over there like an hour, and then I was like, I think I got something that I needed to do for tomorrow morning. So I just start chalking again. I chalk all the way when I get to school, like 6 p.m. So I went to cafeteria, grab some dinner, and then I went to shower a little bit and go back to library study. And then I was too tired. I didn't get anything in my mind because I didn't focus because I was too tired. I went straight back to the dorms and sleep. I woke up in the morning like 5 a.m. and just go to library a little bit. Grab some breakfast and then go to class.
So it was 60 miles?
Yeah.
But with shortcuts, so it could have been longer. So that's good.
I think it's longer.
And then you take the tests, and lo and behold, you come here. And next thing you know, that fellow over there is recruiting you.
Yeah.
Is that right?
Mm-hmm.
Hey, Ryan, see if you can beat that story. Go ahead. I'm going to listen. I'll be right.
I don't know if Andy ran 60 miles any time in the recent past, but here with Andy Powell, the associate head coach at University of Oregon, and you've been with this guy for 2 years now, two dominant years as a distance runner in the NCAA. You see him every day. What's been the most impressive thing you've seen him accomplish so far?
He's done so much. I think after that 60-mile run to school, I think just about anything I've put him through has probably been easy for him. He's done some incredible workouts. Indoor nationals was maybe one of the more impressive performances I've ever seen really any athlete do. Christian was great runner from Montana State, and he was on top of his game. And I asked Ed, he traditionally distance guy, runs the five and the three, asked if for the team points, we kind of had the five covered, if he'd be okay running the mile. He said, sure, whatever helps the team. And I said, well, maybe if we need you, we'll have you run the DMR, but let's see how the other guys run and who makes the final. I said, sure, coach, whatever helps the team. And back of our minds, maybe the 3K the next day. But yeah, I guess after running 60 miles, that quadruple was maybe not as hard to him. But running three sub 4 minute miles, he ran 3:59 in the prelim, anchored the DMR to a win, and then Christian ran a great race, and Ed covered his moves and ended up winning the mile. That was really impressive. And then basically all we had to do was just score some points in the 3K, and the team ended up sweeping the 3K. So that was probably the most impressive thing I've seen him do, was that indoor performance.
Goodness. Edward, or should I call him King Chez, okay?
Yes,
no relation.
King and queen,
King
yes.
and queen, though. Of course, he was undoubtedly a freshman phenom for sure. Sometimes when people come to their sophomore year, they can kind of get in a slump. How have you seen his maturity level rise in order to go from being King Chez freshman year and then going to sophomore year where the bullseye is on his back, so everybody's chasing after him? What kind of mindset did he have going into the sophomore year?
Yeah, I think he was ready. No sophomore slump for sure. I think he was underdog for sure his freshman year, and then sophomore year he was kind of the favorite. But he had great teammates around him, and I think they certainly helped. And he wanted to be the guy that was kind of maybe the top dog. He wanted to be a leader on the team, and he accepted the challenge and did a great job with it.
Rock star, right? Don't they call him rock star? Ask him about that, John.
Impressive story to get here in the States, and obviously here for the Bowerman. John, back up with Edward.
Complete rock star. We heard your coach said, do you have a favorite race of your championships?
Yeah, I said indoors. It's indoor because I ran the prelim, the last day, mile, I ran 3:57. Mm-hmm. And then the next day, coach asked me, like, hey, are you okay if you can help the team to run the TMR? I was like, sure, of course, why not? So I ended up running the DMR and getting the mile. And so that was a good, like, chance for me to run the DMR, because I haven't run the DMR indoors since high school. Mm-hmm. And I asked her, like, hey, I'm going to do that. You know, I'm trying to help the team since we haven't won the TMR for a long time, so we let's try it. So I ended up running that, and I left the team, and we ran really good, and we won that. And then within 24 hours later, I came back for the final mile with the tough guy called Christian Sorandos. Mm-hmm. He was it was a really good runner. He ran like 3:55, and my PR by that time was 4:01, and I haven't broke 4 minutes by that time until the prelim. Oh, until New York. I went to New York for the Melrose Games. I ran 3:56. So I was like, yeah, sure, I can do it. Coach was like, just run your best. You know, if you try to score as highest points for the team, just run. Because I was getting tired from the DMR, and then come back later within, I think, less than an hour or an hour, come back and run the mile finals. So I went to the race. I was kind of nervous, and you know, I was like, whatever happens, happens. I'll try my best. So I went there. My coach was like, hey, you got to smile before you go to the race. So I smiled and I went out like, okay. The race starts, and I was trying to cover his moves as he goes. I have to go with him, and I end up winning that with 3:57.
Jenna, he makes you look like a loafer. It's unbelievable. Real quick, we talked about everybody's parents are here. You said your mom is up in Kenya right now. It's 4 a.m. and she's watching.
Yeah.
You want to say hi to her?
Yeah, he knows already. I wrote, like I told him, like, I'm going to say hi, and she's watching now with my younger sister. And I called him before I came here, like, went upstairs, and I called my mom. I was like, yeah, she's going to watch it. And I'm like, you better watch it. I'll be up there.
All right, here we go. Everybody say hi to Edward's mom. Yeah. Everybody, hi, Mom.
Hi, Mom.
Edward Cheserek, congratulations.
Thanks.
Great season for you.
When you're already a three-time NCAA champion, there are certain lofty and lengthy expectations for your senior year. Doubly so if you compete for a program known as Jumps U. And doubling up is exactly what Florida's Marquis Dendy did during the 2015 season, sweeping the NCAA long and triple jump titles, both indoors and out. Dendy went undefeated in the triple jump in 2015, 5 wins indoor, 3 more outdoors. His winning leap at the indoor championships was the first 57-foot jump under cover since 1986 and landed him at number 3 all time. At the outdoor championships, he blasted a windy 6th rounder of 58 feet 1 and 3 quarter inches, making him just the second collegiate jumper in history, Olympic champ Mike Conley's the other, to surpass 57 feet legally both indoors and out.
I am on pace to kind of being one of the best doublers, and that's kind of like what my goal is. I just want to kind of come out here and just kind of show everyone that, you know, I have the tools and ability to be one of the best.
He starred in Fayetteville and also Eugene, matching career best indoors with a leap of 27 feet 2 inches to win the NCAA title, then moved up to 4th on the all-time list outdoors with a championship leap of 27 feet 8 there at Hayward Field. On the same runway, Dendy then added a U.S. national long jump crown with the longest jump under any conditions in 5 years, 28.5 and a half. On Twitter, his followers know to check the sky, and at the track, you can just check the podium. He is Bowerman finalist Marquis Dendy.
Wow. Every time I come out, I just go, wow, because, I mean, jeepers, everyone, it's like girl watching. The last one to go by is always prettiest. I mean, they're all these resumes are fantastic. You have the Florida indoor record in the triple jump, the indoor record in the long jump, the outdoor record in the long jump, and the outdoor record in the triple jump. Did I get them all? Which one of those is your favorite?
It's just like asking about what's my favorite event. I don't have
Jenna had to do it. You have to do it.
Long and triple jump. That's what I
see think. What you've started. No one's cooperating. Come on.
I guess I can go off of what I won at USA's, so we're going to do that. So I won USA's. That was with 28 feet. But then again, I also think about NCAA's, that did 58 feet, so I don't really, long and triple jump is my answer. I don't know how to give you another one.
Which was the last one you needed to complete the set, for the record?
I think long jump, because I didn't have a win legal one. So I think I did that at USA's, I'm pretty sure. I don't know any of my stats. Coach Pearson knows all that stuff.
So. Oh, we got them all here. Yeah, I got all that. What's the secret to being good at both?
Dual-minded. Yeah. You're like that. Being dual-minded, being able to kind of go to work every day, even though it's Tuesdays I got long jump, triple jump Thursdays I have triple jump. Being able to kind of think about two different legs, because I don't jump off of the same leg. So I got to think dual-minded, I guess, just opposite legs.
What do you mean jump off different legs?
Right leg is only triple jump.
Okay.
And left leg is only long jump. Can't do anything else about it. He tried to. I'm really terrible.
Christian Taylor switch. Why don't you switch?
He doesn't long jump.
There you go. All right. Well, let's go over to Mr. Dual-minded his own self over there with Ryan.
We're down here with Coach Nick Peterson from the University of Florida. The last year and a half of his career at Florida, 6 SEC titles, 6 NCAA titles. Unbelievable. How, as a coach, would you describe the way he closed out his career?
It's incredible. I mean, for me, I feel like a spectator. You know, I just get to sit and watch the show, because you know anytime Marquis is on the runway, he's going to put on a show. So it's just incredible. The things he's accomplished and done, I mean, kind of leaves you speechless.
I mean, that's not the first show from Florida. I mean, they're kind of known as Jumps University. They've had multiple gold medalists, silver, bronze at the World and Olympic Games. But Marquis holds the school records. So what does that say about his future, and what makes him special than any of the other jumpers?
Well, I mean, can't say anything bad about Will or Christian or, you know, any of those guys, because they're obviously very talented. But Dendy, and, you know, I might be shots fired here, but Dendy's the fastest of all of them. So when that's going to help him, you know, especially in that long jump, and we're just going to continue to get better, and hopefully we can follow in their footsteps and put some medals around his chest and around his neck.
So can we look forward to a jumper's 100-meter dash at Florida Relays this year?
They're putting together a 4x1.
Oh, I'm starting something here.
Shots fired all around. John, I think there's about to be a Twitter battle over here.
Well, I want you to keep Coach right there, because I have a question. As long as he's, you know, he's a... Have you ever lost an argument?
to my mom.
That's it?
But no, I lose all the time. Coach Pearson.
Oh, she loses all the time.
I lose all the time. See, you're not going to believe it.
He's never lost an argument a day in his life.
I do.
All right. I'd heard you don't. Okay, we mentioned jumps you. Christian Taylor, Will Clay, Omar Craddock, and Marquis Dendy. So I know you can all long and jump and triple jump. But if I wanted to go dance with one of you guys, who would I go with?
Omar?
If I wanted to sing with somebody.
I don't know about sing, but you can rap with a Will.
I don't think I can. who's the funniest?
Christian.
Really? He's quiet as a church.
Nah, he's hilarious. Don't let that fool you.
All right. If I got in a fight, who do I want?
Omar.
if I need help on an algebra test.
Oh, you can come to me. I can help you with that.
How about if I'm just hanging out and I'm stuck on a desert island, who do I want to be with?
Probably none of us, because we're always going to abandon you. Probably none of us. Yeah, that's not a good look for all of us.
Coach, I love what you fostered there. Congratulations. This is the best of all the Twitters that I've found in searching for this. I don't know if you know this. What happened between you and Pizza Hut? Folks, this is a battle royal raging if you haven't read it.
All right, so some people don't know, but my ritual before every meet, I have to have a pineapple pizza. And for a long time, Pizza Hut, $10 pizza box, I would get a medium pizza, cinnamon sticks, and breadsticks for $10. Like that, I can't pass it up. So I would do that all the time. And sorry, Coach Pearson, but I do eat it before I jump. But so I would eat that, and it was good. I always got my few to go ahead and jump. And it was one day, they did just terrible service. It was not good. They just canceled my order for no reason. And I was so sad because I always tip them. I do everything for Pizza Hut. I talk about them all the time. Everyone always, Papa John's is better, Domino's is better, and I've always been Pizza Hut. And it was a really big letdown. They normally kind of come through for me. So I had to go ahead and just, you know, change up my, you know, renegotiate my contract and drop them.
You went the next day and tried to win the argument with them.
I came through and I said, hey, look, this was my order. And they just said, oh, sorry, the driver must have been tired. I said, well, I'm tired every day at practice. But I can't just show up and be like, I'm not going to come to practice today, coach, because I'm tired. So I didn't really get that excuse. So, now I'm kind of a free agent looking for, you know, new pizza deals out there. So, you know, I've been dabbling with Papa John's and Domino's, you know, not Little Caesars. I don't believe in $5 to be anything for pizza. So, but I do, I'm looking around. I'm gonna figure it out. We're gonna have something. Mm-hmm. Before season starts.
Gotta, that's good.
Got to get on top.
Listen,
of my ritual.
We all got to overcome adversity at some point
absolutely.
In our careers.
Yeah, absolutely.
So good for you. Before I let you go, you promised, we saw it on the runway. I would like you to get everybody here to clap.
Oh, man.
So. Let's see it. Ooh. Ryan.
I'm down here with some past winners. I didn't see any of you guys get the crowd clapping like that in the past. What's going on?
Are you scared?
Don't that, believe that.
That
Don't
was my that. Question for you. Deion Lindor, last year's champ from Texas A&M. At this point in the show, how nervous were you feeling?
I was like, you know, you're thinking about it, but then you're not thinking about it. Then you're kind of hungry, so you're thinking about food. And then again, you know, you're thinking about you want to get the trophy. So, you know, it's mixed emotions.
I won back in 2010, but I can still distinctively remember how I felt before they opened that envelope. What was running through your head waiting for Herman Frazier to open up that envelope and say, Derek, join?
Yeah, I specifically remember the last thing that went through my head was, you're not going to win. I remember seeing the guys that follow me watch their videos, and they were just so incredible that I thought one of them had it for sure.
Okay.
And Goni Makusha, Florida State champ back a few years ago. A lot of the past winners keep coming back to this event to be a part of it. What makes it so special that you guys keep returning?
You know, with every athlete, there's something special about them. So it makes you feel good every year that you're part of a special group with special athletes. So it's an honor to be around these people. So I would like to come until, as long as I'm alive, I want to come back every day so that I can feel good.
Yeah. Well, we're about to add one more special person to this group of past winners. So Herman Frazier, take it away.
Thanks, Ryan. I appreciate it. Before I open up the envelope, I'd just like to make a few comments. First of all, how about welcoming back our wonderful MC, John Anderson from ESPN. John does a terrific job, and as we all know, he was a high jumper at the University of Missouri. Go, John. Okay. Secondly, Jenna Prandini, congratulations to you for winning this evening as well. How about another round of applause for her? The next thing I'd like to say is, Alfreda and I get the opportunity to be here with you, but I would love to tell you about all the meetings, all the discussions we have during the course of the year with the Bowerman Advisory Committee trying to put all of this together. And I think as you look at our six finalists this evening, you can see what a tough job it is to do this. And so to all of you from the Coaches Association and your executive committee who empower us to be able to do this, and Sam Seams and his staff, we salute you for keeping this alive, because this is important for the future of our sport and track and field. So for the rest of you who are out there and who continue to support this event, we say thank you. And to give you some idea, we already had a conference call last Friday to start working on next year's event. So that's how seriously we take this. And so without further ado, the winner for 2015 Bowerman Award from the University of Florida, Marquis Dendy.
My mom said I should have a speech. I don't really have one, so I'm just freestyling. just want to thank everyone who had voted for me. Thank everyone who kind of was always telling me, you know, I look up to you, and you're such an inspiration to all everybody else. Thank you for my parents, my coaches, University of Florida. Thank to those guys down there, Shawn and Chez, man, y'all are amazing. So everything like that. But all of this, everyone here tonight, all this stuff right here wouldn't happen, you know, without God. So I just want to, you know, really, really kind of give that out to that, because it's just amazing that I get to kind of be up here, and it's just amazing. Keandre, if you're watching, please go to sleep. Go to bed. I won. Now you can go to sleep. All right. That's got to get that out there, because he doesn't sleep at all. So, and quick side note, if y'all know my sister, Maya Dendy, this never happened. Don't tell her this. Don't let her know. She don't talk about it in the interview. She doesn't like it. Just let it go. I won. Just, I didn't exist to her. There it is. Thank you very much. I appreciate it.
At this point, Jenna, congratulations. Marquis, congratulations. Have you guys heard of the Sports Illustrated cover dinks? I just happened to throw these in my backpack. Apparently, track and field doesn't have one. Track and field news. You. I'm gonna. So next year, be watching when you get it in the mail. You might know what happens. I would like the finalists to come up. I would like the past winners to come up so we can congratulate them one last time. Everybody, go ahead. This also helps because while you all go to dinner, they have to stay and take pictures. So I've just kind of given you a way to get out without crashing into each other. So the winners, the finalists, the past winners, thank you so much. Families, please stay in the ballroom. I want to thank everyone for coming. I want to thank everyone for caring about these kids and this sport. Tell you Merry Christmas, Happy Holidays, and I will leave you with the quote from my coach in college, Bob Teal, his favorite quote, which is just, as you go out tonight, be loose as a goose and twice as shifty. Thanks, everybody.